I'm Dr. Christopher Mote. Our clinic is Cornerstone Health Community, and today is part three of our series on SIBO, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. I encourage you to watch part one and two before you get to this one. It will make more sense. So here's what we learned in the first one, that the anatomy and physiology works like this. As undigested or poorly digested food moves through the intestine and dumps in the colon, bacteria will overpopulate on that undigested food. They move into the small bowel. It creates symptoms in the abdomen of bloating, gas, pain, loose stools, hard stools. Maybe as bad, it also creates inflammation that causes leaky gut through the small intestine itself. And then the inflammation produced by all those bacteria, the toxins, go through the entire body. Joints, brain, skin, fat cells, all are inflamed now. So how do we deal with this? Well, first let me say that I think we're moving in the wrong direction as a functional medicine profession if all we're doing is breath testing, because that just confirms that we have a problem. But underlying these issues are pathogens, and many in our profession have not understood or moved in that direction. I want to say that if we look for the underlying causes of the inflammation within the gut, we're going to have better success treating SIBO, and the diets don't have to be quite so restrictive, and the processes for cure don't have to be so long. So here's what I'm talking about. In our SIBO patients, we find inflammation that set people up for this overgrowth because we're finding inflammation in the stomach that erodes stomach acid and motility issues, and oftentimes it comes down to a bacterial infection called H. pylori. We find that on a stool test using PCR or DNA detection. In this area, we'll find people who have sensitivity to gluten. And this is the number one area that gets inflamed. It's also one of the primary areas for H. pylori to infect. And the way this works is inflammation in this tissue short circuits the hormone signals to the pancreas as the food is passing by. The pancreas is supposed to be signaled that there's food on the way and release enzymes. When there's inflammation here, those signals never get to the pancreas. There's very little enzyme release. It's not that we lack enzymes, it's that we have inflammation blocking the signals to the pancreas. And so commonly we find H. pylori that causes inflammation in this part of the tissues. Gluten sensitivity, when somebody continues to eat it, will reliably cause inflammation here. And then you can throw in there any number of other parasites like Giardia, mold and yeast like Candida. They all cause inflammation right there, and anywhere throughout here, they change the dynamics of motility. They create a hospitable environment for these bacteria to thrive. And so in the past, we used to try to give digestive enzymes, and we'd give fiber, and we'd give high-dose probiotics, and people felt great as long as they took them. And as soon as they stopped, the problem came back because we never addressed the root causes. Another approach, if you have a prescribing doctor, is to take Xifaxan as a broad-spectrum antibiotic. And sure, that'll wipe out large numbers of all the bacteria, but it does not kill H. pylori if you have it. It does not change the inflammation from your foods, and it absolutely does not treat these other microorganisms. And so within 6 months to a year, we found our patients coming back with the same symptoms. So we don't do a breath test. We do a stool test. We can confirm your symptoms and the test line up and that you have SIBO, but most importantly, we can find out if it's a microorganism, if it's a food, or a combination that is causing this type of overgrowth and motility, and we get treated effectively in the span of 6 months or less.